This morning, I want to talk to you about altars and wells. You say that fast enough and it sounds like somebody's name. Altars and wells. When you look through Scripture, man would build an altar when the Lord would do something. Every time God does something in our life, we build an altar to remember that. We build an altar to honor Him. What He's saying right there is, this is something special I've done for you. So we build that altar as a place of remembrance. When the children of Israel came through the flood of Jordan, the Lord spoke and He said, put 12 stones out. This was an altar. This was an altar of remembrance that for generations they could come back to this place and the children would say, Mom, Dad, what are these big rocks for? Oh, child, your great-great-grandmother and great-great-grandfather were on the other side of this and they were slaves for a season. But when they got to this place, it was flooded, but God told them to go across and He parted the waters so that they could come across so that you could possess the land that you have now. You see this rock, baby? This is Judah's rock. You see this rock, baby? This is Reuben's rock. See, we build an altar when God does something. That altar says, God spoke to me. God healed me. God delivered me. God filled me with His Spirit. That's an altar. There are churches all over America that have altars with cobwebs on them. I don't mean these altars. I mean the altars where God has done something and it's been so long since His Spirit's been in those places. So we build an altar when God does something. We revisit these altars. We come back to these places. Altars can be hot spots. Mark prophesied a few years ago that God was releasing hot spots behind pulpits. Now, I really liked it because of what happened to lead up to that point. I don't remember if he prophesied that before this happened. I believe he prophesied that God was about to release hot spots and then about a week later. Here's the story of what happened. Let me give you the story. Rod Parsley was having this great move of the Lord at his church. So Mark got together with some folks, and they decided, without me, to fly up to Ohio and go to this revival. No, I did not get my feelings hurt. I stayed at home. I got my passy, and I got my bottle, and I sucked my thumb for a while. No, I did not go. I stayed here. A group of them went, which was very eventful. They got layovers and stuck in airports, and it was it was so funny. So anyway, while they were experiencing revival at another church, I decided one night, because I couldn't sleep, that I would come out here and pray. I'm not kidding about them getting stuck in the airport. They really did that. Matter of fact, I'm not kidding about laughing at it, because it was funny. Mark really made it funny. But I came out here to pray, and I was out here, and I was just praying. And this has been 7 years. I don't know how long it's been. It's been several years ago. But I'm out here praying, and I'm praying over the seats in the church, and I'm praying over the people at the church, and I'm praying for all of these things. Now, I was I'm very big on authority, and I'm very big on boundaries. I know my boundaries, and I know other people's boundaries, and I don't like it when people cross their boundaries, and because I don't cross my boundaries. So I looked, and I've never prayed on the stage. I would always pray out there. Why? Because this stage, particularly this area, represents the authority of a pastor. And I was not the pastor. I wasn't even the assistant pastor. I was the pastor's assistant, but I wasn't the assistant pastor. I was the PA, not the AP. So I never would come up here on the stage to pray because I didn't have the authority to be up here. It wasn't my office. It was Mark's office. So I would pray out there, and I would pray for you, and I would go through this place and just pray for revival and all these things. And I got over here, and the Lord spoke to me to come up on the stage, and I was like, but God, I can't do that. And the Lord spoke and said, go up on the stage. No, I'm not that legalistic, but I do respect authority. So I knew where I was supposed to come. There was a spot right over here, and I was supposed to come right over here. I can't tell you why. God did it. I didn't. It wasn't my decision. If it was my decision, the hotspot probably would have been at the house. So I come up on the stage, and I come around back through this way, and I march up to this spot, and when I got here, it was like my feet got stuck immediately. I couldn't move. Threw my hands up, and it was just like this. I can't put words to it. It was like a waterfall, beam me up, Scotty thing. It was just, I was there. It was happening. And I remember so distinctly hearing this sound, kind of like, I didn't realize until later that was my head. Honest to goodness, I didn't feel the equilibrium go sideways. I didn't feel like I fell, but I did remember hearing that boom, and I was praying. I was like, huh, I wonder what that was. I had no idea it was this big old head. I can't tell you if it was 30 seconds. I can't tell you if it was 30 minutes. I can tell you it was awesome. So after that was over, I walked away. I had no clue what this meant. No clue what in the world it meant for me to stand right here and get that. And then next Sunday, Mark gets up, and I can't remember quite if it was closing out worship or what, but he got over here and froze right here. The Lord began to just pour out on him. Next thing I know, he's lining people up in the church to come up on the stage, and they would come up, boom, boom, boom. And I remember so well, because in those days, I was a catcher. I don't mean a baseball catcher. It's easier to catch a 90-mile-an-hour ball than people falling. At least you know which way the ball's going. Some of you people, you don't know which way you're going to go. You're going forward, you're going sideways, back. Are you one of those that just collapse? You know, some people, I finally figured out, we had a lady that was visiting the church for a while, and I finally figured out she was a collapser. You could come up to her and just whack, you know, do the whole Pentecostal, you're going to take it. And she still just, I'm being facetious, but it's true. So anyway, people would come up and they would hit this spot, and boom, the power of God would hit them. One after another, and then we fill the stage with bodies, and then we would drag the bodies off to the side, and then we'd fill the stage with more bodies and wait on these bodies to be resurrected so they could go back to their seats so we could have more bodies. It was amazing. It was a hot spot. There are hot spots in this church right now. I'm not going to tell you where all of them are, because some of them are special. You're going to get over there and mess up my hot spot, and then I'm going to be upset. There are certain spots. It was funny. I was talking to, I believe it was Greg one time. We'd had a prayer service, and he asked me, he said, what's the deal with that spot over there? See, I'm not pointing. If you want a hot spot in this church, pray right where you at. You make a hot spot. So he said, what's the deal with that spot over there? I was like, that's my spot. And he was like, that's my spot. So we're fighting over the hot spot. I'm kidding. You know what it is? That's an altar. That's a place where God has touched somebody. That's a place where God has ministered to somebody. This whole area down here, it's a hot spot. This stage is a hot spot. Why? Because God has spoken from this place. It's an altar to the Lord. See, we make an altar to God, and then we revisit that altar. We revisit the altar to remember what He did. We revisit the altar so that we can say, oh God, do it again. That's good stuff. I know there are certain places I can go when I want to get notes for a service, and there are certain places I don't go. There are certain places in the house I don't sit to get notes. Never had any favor there. I'm not saying it's about the spot. I'm saying there are times that we spend time in prayer in a certain area, and that spot becomes a hot spot because we've spent so much time. That spot is soaked with the presence of the Lord. That spot is where we placed an altar. There are places in your home, Miss Wanda, your bathroom, where you've sat in front of that mirror and prayed to the Lord. That's a hot spot. That's an altar to the Lord. No matter what happens, past, present, or future, that's an altar to the Lord that you can go and say, God, do it again. Let me feel your presence again. This whole place is an altar. The word altar is mizbeach. It comes from the root word to slaughter. When you come to an altar, when there's an altar made, something's going to die. Right? I got tickled in Sunday school. Tamara was, she said, at the altar, something's got to, and then you can hear, she said, God's got to do something. God's got to, and she didn't want to say it. So Ginger just speaks up, kill us! When there's an altar made, something's going to die. When you build an altar, either one of two things. A part of you is going to die. A part of you that needs to die. A part of your flesh is going to die. Or part of the vision that God's given you is going to die. Something's going to die on that altar. Are you making an altar of the flesh? Are you making an altar of a golden image? Are you making an altar of hurt, of offense, of rejection, of unforgiveness? Are you making an altar of sin? And if so, then part of the plan that God has, part of the vision, part of the promise, you're putting it on the altar and say, God, I don't want this. I would rather have my hurt than my promise. I would rather have my rejection than my victory. But when we build an altar to the Lord, then we lay down our hurt, our offense, our unforgiveness, our sin. We lay it down and say, God, I would rather have your victory than my rejection. I would rather have your right than my right. That's an altar. And then we put that on there, and the fire of the Holy Spirit burns what we lay on that altar, and God speaks to us. That's good stuff. Another word for altar is God's table. You know why a word for altar means God's table? Because at his altar, he provides. Another word for altar is harel. And if you're a Hebrew scholar, you can correct me afterwards. I'm probably not going to listen. It means mount of God. Now this one kind of got me. I was thinking an altar, mount of God. So I did what I normally do when I run across something I don't understand. I left it alone. I moved on for a little while so I could revisit. And I came back to it and I was like, mount of God. I kept on moving. I came back, mount of God, kept moving. And then it dawned on me, what does a mountain, the perspective of a mountain is completely different. When you go up on a mountain, when we visit Sean and Mark in Virginia, they have mountains. We have hills. You know, you go out to Red Hill, and you can see all the way from the start of Red Hill to the start of the trees at Marouge. It's about a mile. 2 miles. In Virginia, you can go up on these mountains and you can see clear across Lynchburg. It's amazing. Well, you can clear across to the next mountain. An altar is a mount of God because when we build an altar to the Lord, our perspective is changed. Our perspective, our viewpoint is changed. We're so limited by our own limitations. We limit what God can do based on our abilities. We limit how far we can see based on our natural sight. But when we bring an altar, when we build an altar for the Lord, when we build an altar to the Lord, then all of a sudden our perspective begins to change and God begins to give us revelation. He takes us above the circumstance and allows us to see clear into the distance. He allows us to see into the future what we cannot see in the natural. And then there's another word for altar that is Ariel, and it means lion of God. I love that one. I love God's provision. I love God's perspective. But when you hear the lion of God, you know what that means? That means the battle's over. That means you've won. That means that when you make an altar to the Lord and the Lion of Judah roars, when Jesus roars, when the lion roars, then your enemies go running scared. The altar is a place that we come and we lay down our will, our desires. This is one of the biggest things in the charismatic movement. The charismatic movement has brought us so many great revelations, so many great understandings. The charismatic movement has worked hard to break off the legalism of religiosity. It has worked hard to break free of the deadness of dry religion and move into the Spirit. But along with the accesses, people have got it, and they've come into rebellion, and they've taken the extreme view of this, and they begin to seek their will and not God's. You cannot make an altar to God and then put His will on the altar so that you can receive yours. That's when you move into witchcraft, plain and simple. And there's so much of that rampant in the church today. When people can, I heard a thing the other day where a lady was inviting someone to a witch's meeting. And the lady said, "I'm a Christian, I can't do that." She said, "Oh, I'm a good witch." So the devil's a good devil? No. There's good and there's evil. When you mix the two, you know what you get? Evil. There's no yin and yang in Christianity. We come to the altar and we put our will on the altar. We put our plans on the altar. We put our desires on the altar. We stop and we say, "God, not my will, but your will. Not my plans, but your plans. Not my thoughts, but your thoughts." And when we do this, when we come and we build an altar to the Lord and we lay our plans, I say, "God, this is my plan. This is what I want in life, but I'm going to lay it on the altar for you to consume it. Lord, this is the way I think it should look. This is the process that I want. I really don't want to go through a pit Potiphar's house in prison. I would rather go through a small apartment, medium-sized house, and a big house." "That pit's so lonely, God. There's no air condition in that hole." You know what happens if you have a church with no air condition? You have no members. Unless it's winter and you better have heat. God, I lay down my desire for the process. I lay it down. Oh, Lord, my plan is to go from high school to CEO, but Lord, I'm going to lay that plan down and I'm going to submit to your process. We trade our plans, our wills, our thoughts for His plans, His will, and His thoughts, because His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. We lay ourselves down and say, "God, it's not about what I intended. I am not in life where I thought I would be when I was 17 years old. I was so smart when I was 17. Oh, my goodness. I should have done so much before I forgot everything I knew." Seriously. Man, I wouldn't have a financial worry. The church would be on every major network in the world. Right? At 17, you have it all figured out. And you're invincible. I discussed that. I didn't confess about my driving last week. I am not going to confess again. But at 17, you're invincible. And Pam, don't even laugh. We used to race. See, y'all didn't laugh that much. I heard Pam back there laughing. I was like, "I know she's laughing." You know why? Because, thank you, because it was guilt. That was a guilt laugh. She told me one time, she said, "If I turn my air off when we're racing, I can beat you." It's okay. She was right. I turned my ear off, and you know what happened? Them squirrels didn't do any better than what they were doing before. Oh, I'm so glad Mom and Dad didn't let me get a sports car when I was that age. I found a little Mustang with a V8 one time. Dave said, I'm not letting you have that." I said, "Daddy, I'm paying for it." He said, "I don't care. I'm paying the insurance." In hindsight, he was so smart. Anyway, I'm going to move on because I'm going to open up into confession, and this is not my altar today. My altar is to the Lord, not to confess to you. I could have won downhill, maybe. The first altar in Scripture is in Genesis chapter 8. You can look at it. It's Genesis chapter 8, verse 20. It says, "Then Noah built an altar to the Lord and took some of every clean animal and some of every clean bird and offered burnt offerings on the altar. Now, what happened here, God had just judged the world, and he put Noah and his family and two of every animal on a boat, and they just, can you imagine for one second being on a closed-in boat with a bunch of animals? You know what? I don't know that my mama would have survived that. The only dog that's been in her house was when she was not there. And I didn't. Mark snuck one in a couple times when it was cold outside. And she still knew. They just came through this. The whole world was destroyed except for what God allowed Noah to save. And the first thing he did was he climbed off that boat and he built an altar to the Lord. And he said it was in remembrance of God's salvation through that season. It was in remembrance on God sparing them. Was it pleasant? No. Guess what? There are things we have to go through in life that are not pleasant. But everything works for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose. Whatever wilderness season we have, it will end with a promised land if we don't get stuck in the wilderness. He made an altar. The next altar we see is in Genesis chapter 12, verse 7. And then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, "To your offspring I will give this land." So he built there an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. The Lord comes to Abram and he makes him a promise. So the moment that the Almighty God promises something to Abraham, he said, this is a place of covenant. This is a place where God made a covenant with me, and I'm going to build an altar to mark this place where he has visited me. And if I'm going to get through these notes, we're going to hurry. In Genesis 22, verse 9, I'm not just going to give you every verse in Scripture about an altar, but I'm making a point. In Genesis chapter 22, verse 9, we find out why the altar means God's table. Abraham was about to go place Isaac on the altar. So here they go. They're marching up, and they're going to sacrifice. Isaac doesn't know what's going on. And in verse 9 it says, "When they came to the place which God had told them, Abraham built the altar there and laid the wood in order and bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar on top of the wood." This was the moment that God told his servant. He told Abraham, "I've given you a promise, and now I want you to put your promise on my altar." If God promised you something and you have been waiting and waiting and waiting all of those years and you received your promise and then you got to enjoy it for a short time and then God said, "Now, kill it." Man, what a test of obedience. Abraham says, "Lord, not my will but yours. Not my plans but yours. Not my ways but yours." So he places Isaac on the altar, and God provides a ram. It's God's table. He's looking for our obedience. He's not, sometimes we have this mentality in church that God's looking for some way to hurt us. Have you ever seen people like that? They automatically assume that whatever they do, it's going to be something for God to hurt us. God's not looking to hurt you. Nor is he looking to excuse our sins. There's a balance in this. It's a relationship. He's looking to train us. He's looking to educate us. He's looking to mature us. He doesn't want a bride that's got a bottle. He wants a mature bride. He wants warriors. He provided for Isaac. In Genesis 26, 25, you can actually skip that one because we're going to come back to that one. But this is where God opened up the wells for Isaac. And he made an altar there for covenant. In Genesis 33, 20. Jacob comes out to meet Esau. And he had just left Esau, and it says there he erected an altar and called it El Elohi Israel. This is so cool because Jacob was going to meet Esau in his own strength. and he was terrified. So the night before, he sends everybody away from him, and he spends the night by the river. And then the angel shows up and wrestles with him. And then at the breaking of day, the angel, which I personally think is Jesus, and by the way, that angel was not struggling. The moment that the angel wanted to get his attention, he just went, thump, knocked his hip out of socket. It's not like he was struggling, but Jacob was so fearful in the natural. He was so, he knew that he was outmatched and outweighed, and he would not let go. And he said, I won't let go until you bless me. And he said, fine, you have a new name. You have a new identity, and your new name is now Israel. Now let me go. So then he plans this whole thing. He sends the wife and the kids out first with presents. You know, what a man of honor right there. I think Esau's going to kill us, so I'm going to, babe, why don't you take the kids and some presents, and I'm going to pull up the back in case he tries to flank us from the rear, okay? You just go ahead. Is that not, leaving out the humor, that's the story that's there. He sends the kids, sends the wives. Well, he sends Leah first, and then he sends Rachel. God, I'm going to let the not-so-pretty wife go first. I'm going to keep the pretty one just in case that one's enough. I'm not going there. I don't have a Leah. I just got a Rachel. I better watch out because she's going to send me first. God prepared the way. He softened Esau's heart. When Esau saw him, he embraced him. So immediately Jacob saw something. He said, I have lived my life by my own accomplishments. I have done things my own way, and I paid a price for that. And then God gives me instruction with my father-in-law, and I'm blessed. He gives me a new name, and now I come out to my enemy that can destroy me, and he embraces me. Oh God, I place an altar in this place today, and I'll say, no longer will I be Jacob, but I will be Israel. No longer will I be deceiver. That's good stuff. Now, let's go to Genesis 25 and then Genesis 35, 28. Chapter 35. And then chapter 28. Verse 1 of 35 says, and God said to Jacob, arise and go up to Bethel and dwell there. Make an altar there to the God who appeared to you when you fled from your brother Esau. So let's jump back to Bethel at chapter 28. What happened was when Jacob was running from his brother, he takes off on this journey and he gets to this place. And in chapter 28, starting in verse 10, it says, Jacob left Beersheba and went toward Haran, and he came to a certain place and stayed there that night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones of that place, he put it under his head and lay down in that place to sleep, and he dreamed. And behold, there was a ladder set up on the earth, and on top of it, it reached into heaven. And behold, the angels of God were ascending and descending. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father, the God of Isaac, and the land on which you lie, I will give to you and to your offspring. Your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west and the east and the north and the south, and in you and your offspring shall the families of the earth be blessed. Behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go and will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is a gate of heaven. Jacob, he gets to this place, he's tired, he sleeps, God gives him this dream, and he looks up and he says, I did not know God was even here, but this is a special place. This is an open heaven. This is a gateway into heaven, and I will mark this place forever. But he didn't build an altar. Years later, God wakes him up and says, go back to where I spoke to you. Go back to where I made covenant, because I wasn't making covenant with a deceiver. I was making covenant with Israel, but you were still Jacob. Now you're Israel. Go back to where you started. Go back to where I spoke to you and make me an altar. In Genesis 13, Abraham had just went through a journey, and he gets to a place between Ai and Bethel, and he builds an altar, and then he makes this journey. And then in chapter 13, it says, so Abram went up from Egypt, he and his wife that he had, and Lot with him. Now Abram was very rich in livestock and silver and gold. And he journeyed on from Negev as far as Bethel to the place where his tent had been at the beginning. At Bethel and Ai, to the place where he had made an altar at first. And there Abram called upon the name of the Lord. See, what God does is we go through a cycle, we go through a season, and then we get to this place, and God says, now the time is here. Go back to where you started. Go back to where I spoke to you. Go back to my altars. Go back where I filled you with my spirit. Go back where you got healed. Go back where you got saved. Revisit those emotions. Fall back in love with your first love. This place right here is one huge altar to me. I cannot tell you how many times as a teenager I would come out here and I would vacuum the carpet and just pray the whole time. There was one time I got stuck on the vacuum, not stuck on the vacuum. I put the vacuum down and just began to cry in this place. We used to come out here on Saturday nights, the young adults group, and we would sit here in a circle and discuss the Word of God, and then we would pray. So many awesome events took place. That's an altar. See, we got to remember, we got to recall those things. Oh, I remember when the power of God was so strong in this house that nobody could even stand up. Everybody in this place was on their face. There wasn't a chord being played. There wasn't a lyric being sung. It was just silence. All you could sense was the kabod, the weight, the glory of God. Oh, there was a time I remember when the glory cloud floated around this place. That's an altar. Some people don't believe in the glory cloud. You know what I say to that? I don't care. You believe whatever you want to believe. I saw it. Some people don't believe in prophetic. Some are just pathetic. I'm leery of what claims to be prophetic, but I do not doubt what is prophetic. When the Lord speaks to somebody and they tell you things that they have no way of knowing. I've been praying for things and have somebody either pray or speak over me the very thing that I was just praying for that nobody knew about. Wednesday night, I just wanted to gather together and begin to declare some things. Power of God was just so sweet in this place. Ms. G-Fake released a prophetic word. I go to take the mic back from her, and she did this number. You know what that means? You ain't getting it. The moment she got right there, I knew something. She's fixing to pray for me. Actually, my thought was, she better pray for me. Honest truth. So I got in my prayer stance. Get my balance. I don't resist God knocking me down. I just want to know it's God. Well, no, it ain't just because I was looking up. She started walking. The closer she got, I felt like I was shaking all over on the inside. And I was like, oh, my goodness. She began to prophesy over me things that I've been praying for she didn't know about. A few things may have been able to be produced from general knowledge. That's not what happened. God was speaking to her so quick. Some things she said, nobody could have known about. Nobody knew but me and God. And I didn't tell, so he did. I believe in prophecy. When you get that, when somebody truly is operating by the gift of the Spirit and they release something over you, that's an altar. Oh, God. See, this is what David did in 1 Samuel 30, verse 6. This is what he did. He had the prophet come to him and anoint him to be king. So when all of his men were about to kill him, when all of them talked about stoning him, he got on his knees and he said, but God, you told me I was going to be king, so I'm binding myself to your promise. There is no man, there is no demon, there is no force that can stop me from getting where you told me I would be. That's an altar. Some altars are physical. This is a physical altar. Some altars are emotional. Some altars are just memories. You can stop. We were in this service and they began to sing a song. This little girl, oh my goodness. 5 foot, 90 pounds, shaved head on one side. I mean, we were so far in the back, I didn't even see her walk up. I just know the guy went over there and started pulling the mic down where she could, I didn't even think she could see over the keyboard. She's like, that voice she had, I don't know where she was hiding the rest of her. That didn't come out of a 90-pound body. Her lungs were 90 pounds. She began to sing a song. I began to cry. That song, the last time I remember hearing it, I was riding in a 1977 Thunderbird on a console when we were driving to South Carolina going to PTL. Those are days that every step that my parents took was so guided by the Lord. And they took steps of faith. And those steps were what birthed this ministry. She began to sing. And I'm reminded of the altar that was laid in the front seat of a Thunderbird car. I was reminded of an altar that was raised at the corner of Collingston Road and Airport Road in a little building. I was reminded of an altar that was placed, that was raised, that was built in a printing building with a leaky roof. I was reminded of an altar that purchased 100 acres of land when nobody said it could happen. I was reminded of an altar that we are standing in today. See, we need to revisit those altars. Let me hurry up. I do believe that this place represents a gate of heaven, as Jacob put it, an open heaven above this ministry. It's amazing to me that we can have visiting ministers that have come into this place and they'll tell us, you know, I've never really operated in the prophetic, and I operate in the gifts, you know, tongues, interpretation, gifts of healing, so forth, but I've never operated in the prophetic, and then I minister at the upper room and all of a sudden the prophetic gift begins to flow. Why? There's an open heaven above this place. It's a hot spot. It's a gateway. It's an altar. We need to remember this. Turn to Genesis chapter 26. I'm going to hurry, believe it or not. I actually don't know how long I've been preaching. I looked at the clock, but I looked too fast. So, one day we're going to have one of those churches where we can put a big clock on the back wall. I didn't say we're actually going to do it. I said we're going to have one that we can put a clock on the back wall. Either that or I'm going to set it like an hour behind. It's only 11:30. I just try to make it by the time you get to the restaurant that everybody's already eaten and you can come in without a crowd. That's all. That's my goal. By the way, if you were in the Mobile area, be careful which restaurants you eat at. Brenda, how'd you do it? We went to IHOP. Oh, that's what I said after I left. Only four of us there. Right here, your four tables were taken. It took like an hour and a half to get the food. Anyway, I'm not going to gripe. Poor little thing. She was overloaded. There was a lot going on in her head. I don't know what it was, but it was not our food. Anyway, Genesis chapter 26. I love this passage. I love this chapter. This is Isaac. It was funny. When I went to India, Mark asked me to go to India with him. I think that was part of the, not the assistant pastor, but the pastor's assistant position. So we went to India, and I was really praying for the Lord to give me. I had not preached to that point. Matter of fact, the only thing that I'd really done as far as public speaking outside of school, which I was terrified at school, I did horrible in public speaking. It was just, man, them people are so intimidating when you look at them. So the only time I remember public speaking here at the church was right after Daddy passed away. We had watch night service, and I was trying to give something, some hope and encouragement. So I gave Abraham Lincoln's story, thinking that would be a word of encouragement. And, you know, at the end of it, he dies. So I get up and I'm and everybody's laughing at me. I mean, like hysterically, my mother falls out of her chair. Mark rolls over on the floor, and I'm thinking, and I'm serious. I'm trying. That was the last time they let me speak. That was in 2004, and it was 2008 when we went to India. 4 years that cost me. So, I'm kidding. I guess it explains it anyway. So we get to India, and I'm praying the Lord will show me, and the Lord did minister several things to me, but there was I told you before that there was one service that we had, and we were going to speak that morning and that night, and that morning I was supposed to have like 30 minutes or so, and it went over horribly. I mean, it was one of the most embarrassing moments of my life. I came in the church one day and my suit split. I would much rather that happen than this service. I mean, it was just awful. And so, I mean, even the bishop's wife that was over it came to me and just hugged me afterwards. And the women don't hug men. So she hugged me and said, it will be okay. So that afternoon, I was beating myself up pretty good, and I was asking the Lord to show me something. And I had been studying on Genesis 26, redigging the wells. So the Lord began to take me to redigging the wells. Well, what I did not know was my mother was here ministering, redigging the wells at the very same time. And I got up that night, and I began to deliver this word about redigging the wells to the persecuted church. And they began to, literally, they clapped, they cried, they laughed. That morning, they did all those same things, but it was not in a good way. They clapped when I was over, they laughed when I was not being funny, and they cried through most of it. That night, the presence of the Lord was on that message, and I got back and I was so excited. And then my mother started saying, well, I've been teaching on redigging the wells. The message we had was not the same message. She had one part, I had another part, and it completed. Throughout the years, I've revisited that message so many times, and I've had that stirring in me the last several days, the last 2 weeks, I've had stirring in me redigging the wells. And I'll tell you something that's kind of funny. I was in my office a few weeks back, and I go to leave at the end of the day, and I felt to go get one of Daddy's tapes and listen to it. Now, we have a closet full of his tapes back there, and I haven't got them out in all of these years, and all of a sudden, I felt to start listening to his old tapes. So I began to get them out, and I began to listen to his old tapes. I've only made it through a few of them, and that man is funny, period. A scholar and a comedian, all in the same time. It's amazing. See, that was God instructing me to go redig the wells. To reunite with the heart of the founder. So, and at this meeting even, at one point, I actually went out. I'll confess to you, it was at the end of a service, they were praying, and I snuck out. I know that's just horrible for the preacher to sneak out there and pray. I want to go buy a book. So I went and bought a book. So anyway, he began to declare, redigging the wells. Everything that the Lord has been laying on our heart, it was just like one after another after another. So let me rush through this real quick so I can hit a few points. When we redig the wells, it is referring to a reopening the wells up. Whenever we dig a well, whenever God instructs us to dig a well, it is when we open something up. My mother and my father have dug so many wells in this ministry. My brother has dug so many wells in this ministry. I have dug wells in this ministry. The people of this church have dug so many wells in this ministry through the years. There is a well of healing in this ministry. There is a well of deliverance in this ministry. There is a well of the power, the manifest presence of the glory of God in this place. And there's so many times we go and we leave these wells and we forget to go back and revisit them. So look at the verse that I didn't write down. I thought you'd like that. Let's start in verse 12. And Isaac sowed in the land and reaped in the same year 100-fold. The Lord blessed him. The man became rich and gained more and more until he became very wealthy, and he had possessions and flocks and herds and many servants, so that the Philistines envied him. Now the Philistines had stopped and filled with earth all the wells that his father's servants had dug in the days of Abraham. That word stopped, I have a nice Hebrew word for you somewhere. It's sotham, and it means to stop up, to keep in secret, to close, or to hide. And I got to thinking about that. Does not the enemy do that? He tries to hide. You start getting close. You begin to press into the Lord and you start feeling something stirring. You begin to feel something move, or you have a real good service, and then the enemy wants to come in and hide that well. Oh no, don't let him get a hold of the well of healing. Let's go show them the well of Obamacare. Oh, don't let them get a hold of the well of deliverance. Let's go show them the well of addiction. Oh, don't let them get a hold of the well of the glory of God. Let's give them the well of entertainment. They stopped them up with earth. The word earth is ophar, and it means dust, dirt, rubbish. It is the things of the world. Man, we begin to open up a well in our life, and Satan comes in with the things of the world, desires of the world, lust of the world, focuses of the world, things of the world. When you have to drop a disco ball from a church so that you can bring more people in, something's not right. If it takes techno music to get you saved, you got a lot of problems. You're going to need deliverance when you get saved from the wah, 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 wah. That's all I hear when I hear techno. 90% of y'all have no idea what I'm talking about. Y'all don't know what techno is. And then verse 16. It says, then Abimelech said to Isaac, go away from us, for you are much mightier than we are. Satan tries to negotiate with you. He will try to threaten you. He will try to intimidate you. He will try to push you away. He will do anything he can to get you away from the wells that God is calling you to dig. You go on. I'm gonna spare you the time of reading the whole thing for you. They go down and they begin to reopen the well of Essek. Essek means strife. And then they move away from that one and they begin to open up the well of Sitna. And Sitna means contention or quarreling. Let me tell you something, and this is a great Facebook warning for you. There is so much drama and so much strife around us today, especially with social media. If you want drama, then log on to one of your accounts, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat. I'm lost after that. I have a Twitter and a Facebook, and I don't do Twitter very often because they don't let me talk enough. Every time I go to put something, it's got the little negative and the red number, and I'm thinking, what? I didn't even say anything yet. Hashtag. Can't put a hashtag. There's no room. The moment God begins to do something, Satan brings in division or strife or contention. God begins to do something in a family, guess what? Mom and daddy begin to fight. God begins to do something in a church, the leadership on the staff begin to disagree on how to get there. Or somebody in the church gets mad at the pastor, or somebody gets mad at the worship leader. It's all your fault. You didn't bring the glory. That's my excuse. That's how Satan works. All of a sudden, division comes in, strife comes in, and we are drawn to drama. The news sells negative news. There's so many good things happening. Do you see that on Fox News? No, I don't guess you do. I don't watch a whole lot of news. I go to the internet. I don't see it on the internet sources that I go to either. Drudge has never shown me good news. WorldNet Daily, they don't cover the good things that are happening around the world. They'll cover all the negative. Why? Because we are drawn to negativity. We are drawn to drama. We go on Facebook. Oh, no, she didn't. I cannot believe she said that. I'm not going to post anything because I don't want them to think that I'm talking about them. So I'm going to go to my page and I'm going to post something about that, but I'm not going to name any names. That way I didn't talk about them. Oh, no, she didn't do that. Facebook is the world's best passive-aggressive tool. Somebody does something and you go to your page, I can't stand it when people do this. And they say, are you talking about? No, I ain't talking about you. What you talking about? I was talking about somebody else that you don't even know. See, Isaac was looking and he says, you're over here fighting over something. Don't fight over this. This is not something to quarrel over. God has called us to redig a well and you're digging it out and they're putting it in. You're wasting your time. Leave the strife alone. Leave the drama alone. Get over here into the presence of God. If y'all are on there talking about me on Facebook, I ain't even read it. I kept up with Facebook during the election last time because I wanted to see what I was being called, and it was ugly. It hurt my feelings. I got over it, but it hurt my feelings. I was called a devil. I was called all kinds of stuff. I was called Antichrist one time. And I was thinking, people, you don't know nothing. Don't anybody even know me. I did get a call or text the other day that confirmed that I had someone confirm to me that there is no chance that Donald Trump is the Antichrist because him and the Pope are fighting and that just wouldn't work. That's the honest truth. And Keith has stepped out, so I can't blame it on him yet. But when he comes back, everybody look at him because he's the one I was driving down the road. He said, hey, good news. Trump's not the Antichrist. I was thinking, what? He said, him and the Pope are fighting, and the false prophet Antichrist can't fight yet. I think I've left my well. Moving on. See, that's all about that drama. In case you're wondering, I'm so disillusioned right now with our political system and our candidates, and I don't have a candidate that I like. I did have one, but then he's kind of let me down a little bit. I'm going to have to, one day I'm going to talk to him and explain to him, one, you know, there is a hell. Let's start there. Anyway, I'm moving. Thank you for coming back. I just talked about you. I was sharing the revelation that you gave me that Donald Trump is not the Antichrist. So, moving on, after that, I can feel the stares from the live stream at the moment. I know who you are, and I do love you. Oh, my phone's going to be blowing up after the service, so let me move on. After Essek and after Sitna, they began to dig a well, and it opened up with water, and there was no strife, and there was no contention, and they called it Rehoboth. And they said, God has made room for us. The word Rehoboth means wide. It means room. It means space. It means street, and it means path. Now, this is something very interesting because this is what I feel God's doing. See, I believe that the moves of past are culminating into a new move, right? And I'm not going to get into that. I've shared that so many times before. Tim Sheets, Dutch Sheets' brother, gave a word the other day, and he explained this in such a way that quite frankly, I never would have came up with this. So it was amazing. He put into a scriptural visualization of what is happening in this move of God that is coming. I will probably share some of that with you tonight. I want to get into some prophetic declaration tonight as well. But when they got to Sitna and they got to Essek, it was strife. And then we got to Rehoboth. This was a new well. Rehoboth was not Abraham's well. This was a new well. So first they undug, they reopened the wells that Abraham had dug. And then God said, I brought you full circle. Full circle is not bringing you back to a place before just to leave you. It is not a reset button. When you hear that, sometimes back in the day, me and Mark used to go rent a Nintendo because that was what we had. They didn't have PlayStation and all this other cool stuff, and they didn't have Bluetooth. And I'm no good at video games anymore, but back then, I was the Mario King of the house. Now JL says, I'd rather play the computer because, Daddy, you're no good. So anyway, it had a little reset button on. When you got messed up, you got jammed up, you hit that little button, and it just started all over. Coming full circle is not a reset button. It's not putting you back so you can repeat what you've been through. It's taking you back to where God spoke to you in the beginning so he can complete what was left off in the past.
See, right here, Abraham started digging the wells, and then when Isaac comes, he continues, he reopens those wells, and then God says, keep on going. I've got something new I'm going to do. Yes, I'm bringing some of the old, but I'm bringing something new. I'm doing a new thing in this place. See, we have wells of revival in this house, but there are new wells that are being opened up, and there are going to continue to be new wells that are being opened up. The next well that he began to dig was Beersheba, and he made an altar there. Beersheba means covenant. He stopped and he said, God, you have made covenant with me. See, it's great that God made covenant with my father. It's great that God made covenant with my mother. It's great that God made covenant with my brother. But God's made covenant with me in this house. God's made a promise to me as the pastor of this house. God's made covenant for us, for this generation of this house. So we join. We go back to the altars that were built by those that have laid them before us. And then we build new altars side by side with them. We go back and we redig the wells of intercession and of revival that were dug so many years ago. But we dig new wells of deeper prophecy, of deeper revelation, of a global outpouring. That's where we are. Let me give you three things that Dutch said that really hit home. One, you cannot move forward without revisiting your past. Two, the future is connected to the past. Three, God does not start over. He reconnects where the past left off. For the Upper Room Church, that's what's happening. God is reconnecting us with the past. My father was an apostle, in many ways a prophet, in every sense of the word a pastor. He was a great man. And he and my mother working side by side birthed a ministry based on prophetic word and prophetic direction. And we have seen some of the greatest revival in this place. And when we lost him in 2003, it was a shock and awe moment. It was a shock and awe season. We didn't stop. Mark was in the pulpit the following Sunday. Still don't know how he did that. The last many years, there's been a season of survival, a season of maintaining. It's not because we miss God somewhere along that. That's been the season that God has had us in. It's the season that he's had the body of Christ in. Go down to Brownsville Assembly and see what they've been doing. They've been maintaining. Go up to Smithton and see what they've been doing. They've been maintaining. Go to Toronto and see what they've been doing. They've been maintaining. It's been a season of maintaining in the body of Christ. It doesn't mean that people haven't been growing or advancing, but look around at the average church attendance in America right now, and it has plummeted since 2000, period. I don't care what denomination. I don't care what schemes and plans and tactics. We've been through a wilderness, but the season has changed. For everything there is a season, for everything there is a time, and there has been a time to maintain and a time to survive. But now is a time of coming full circle where God is reconnecting us where the past left off, and we are not going to stay at this point where the past left off. He is taking us back to that place so that we can advance into the future. See, God is the God that transcends time. He doesn't see past, present, future like we see. When he speaks it, it is present to him, and he has already decreed revival in the world. He has already decreed for the Upper Room Church to be lit on fire with revival. He's already decreed the promise in your life to be fulfilled. He's already decreed the promise in my life to be fulfilled. So for him, that's not future, that's present. Now stand with me this morning. I'm excited about what God's doing. I may not be the best at using my words, but there's emotions on the inside of me that I wish to goodness that I could just pour into a glass of water and let you drink it so you could feel what I feel. Because what I see for the future of this ministry, and God has laid a few people on my heart very heavy in this past couple months, and the future that I can feel, this emotion that God has given me, is so incredible. And it's all about revival. That's what God's doing. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, I thank you this morning. Lord, I thank you for where we've been and where we are and where we are going to. Lord, I thank you for every well that has been dug through this ministry. I thank you, Lord, for every altar that has been built upon this ministry. And Lord, today we revisit the altars. I revisit the altars of salvation where so many people have been saved through this ministry. I revisit the altar, Lord, of healing where so many people have been healed in this place. I revisit the altar of deliverance. I revisit the altar, Lord, where you spoke to us and we made an altar and we said Yahweh has spoken. Well, we redig the well that released the flowing of water in this place. We released that well. We uncapped that well this morning, Lord, that released the glory of the Lord in this place. And Lord, we give testimony of all the great things that you have done. We give testimony. For your word, testimony means to do it again. So Lord, we give testimony of the glory cloud in this place. We give testimony of the services, Lord, that the weight of your glory was so heavy we could not even stand in this place. We give testimony of seeing terminal illness healed in this place. And today, Lord, we say, do it again. Lord, we ask you, oh God, we declare in this place that the move of your spirit is not over. But Lord, there's been a season of wilderness. There's been a season of maintaining, but we are in a season of advancing. And Lord, we shake the dust off from this wilderness season. We shake the dust off from the warfare. We shake the dust off from Jezebel. And we declare in this place. We declare in this place revival. We declare through this ministry revival. We declare in this ministry healing. Lord, I thank you this morning that, Lord, every person, whether in this house or watching, that is hurting on the inside, Lord, that you are just healing them right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, those emotional wounds are being healed. Those physical ailments are being healed. And I ask you, Lord, to place a hunger. A hunger in the hearts of your people. Lord, that when we come in this place, we are hungry walking in. We're hungry to hear a word from you. Not a personal word of prophecy. If that comes, great. If it doesn't, great. But a true word of you in this season. That we come in seeking to feel your presence. Not goosebumps, but Lord, an authentic, tangible embrace of your Holy Spirit. We declare revival in this place. Lord, I thank you for our young people in this ministry. I ask you, O Holy Spirit, to grab our young people up right now. To embrace them like a father, to hug them. Lord, I ask you for your protection and your guarding over our young people. We all say that when a person gets to those teenage years, that we can expect them to go through that rebellious season and walk away from you, Lord. But today we declare over our young people, Lord, keep them in your will. Keep them in your presence. We don't have to accept what has been norm for so long. We don't have to accept what the society says it's going to be. We protect our children and those that were raised in this church and that have walked away. We declare today, come home. Satan, get your hands off of our kids. Come home. We break the hopelessness. We bind the hopelessness this morning off of our young people. Lord, I thank you. Every person that has been a part of this ministry, Lord, there are seeds in them. And Lord, today we lay claim to our seeds. We lay claim to those seeds. And we say, oh, fruit, come forth. Well, we don't give up. We don't give up, oh God. Lord, we've been tired and we've been wearied, but Lord, we don't give up. Lord, we are taking a shovel in the hand and we are opening up the wells. Lord, we are taking bricks in our hands and we are building altars. Lord, we are laying the sword aside for a season so that we can build the altars and open up the wells. And we say, oh God, fight our battles for us. Lord, we've been so wearied in warfare, so distracted with the fight with the devil. We release that fight today. We shake the dust off of this fight and we ask you, oh God, fight our war. Fight our war, God, so that we can build your altars. Fight our wars, Lord, so that we can dig your wells. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.